Right, starting a solo playthrough of Pillars of Eternity. Normal difficulty. I don't particularly want to try the harder ones. I feel you really need to know the character class very well if you want to try the harder difficulty. I mean, how to really game the abilities. Not sure if I even want to try. I'm unlikely to record it anyway, even if I tried. Normal difficulty is good enough for now. I don't want to try Iron Man mode or Expert mode. Just want to see what it takes to play through the game with a single, relying on your own character only. Been thinking about the class quite a bit. I'm sure everyone can do it. No doubt about that. It's more of a, what would I find interesting and what might be a good character to use anyway. There should be some kind of a intro. I'm going to skip most of that crap. I can't skip dialogue entirely. Because reputations and things like that will be decided based on dialogue choices. So I can't exactly just ignore it. But I don't want to read things out loud either. It just takes a huge amount of time. I've already done that one, so this, while different options, different type of characters, different choices might lead to new things, I still don't think that's worth just going through every dialogue just because of that. The class. I tried a few classes. I basically made a level 11 character, tried them out in a very standard bounty fight. See how they fare. Barbarian was exceptionally good. I mean, I just made the character, didn't put in any proper equipment or anything, just basic armor and weapon and just tried it out. Barbarian is exceedingly good. It's fairly easy to hit. But the fight didn't last long enough for anyone to really seriously threaten him. Very high endurance, very high health. Low deflection, right, one of the lowest in fact. And accuracy isn't that amazing either, but Jesus fuck the abilities that allow you to do damage. Fantastic, absolutely fantastic. Like, and I think they... Yeah, this is one of the reasons why they're so good. When barbarians hit with melee attacks, they automatically make reduced damage attacks to all enemies within a short distance of the target. Basically, if you attack anyone, almost everyone around you will take damage. So, and you have a lot of special abilities that allow you to deal more damage. So, you can very easily just annihilate a large group of enemies, while any other guy would have to try to disable them or individually hack them to pieces. It takes a lot of time, forces you to tank for a long time, while the barbarian can just make a bloody mess out of them in a few seconds. Chanter, I think, could do it, but it's Chanter doesn't have any bursting power really. Not initially. If he uses his invocation, he uses his load and he'll have to basically regain the chant phrases again before he can cast. So I think this would be sort of a doable, but sort of a slow burn. Steady, slow burn that will win you the fight in the end. But it's probably a very time consuming to do anything either. Cypher would have the offensive capability because they had high damage, high disabling spell power. Don't have spell uses either. and a reasonable ways to gain focus. So if you have any kind of solid ways to earn focus in a fight, I have no doubt a Cypher can easily win it. Druid would be somewhat interesting, sort of the wizard too. I'm sure they have the offensive capability. I don't want to play with a wizard because I played with a wizard initially. It might have been an interesting choice. Druid has a worse spell selection but also has summons. And the attack selection is capable. Shapeshifting, so could do melee too. Fighter, I don't know if there's anything particularly good about it. It has a lot of survivability, but that's all it has. It would be, I think, a dull class to play overall. Monk, sort of similar, a bit more interesting. Paladin, probably the same, but it has a lot of good saving throws, probably ways to get your defense up. But more or less, I think they're in the same boat. They don't have nearly the attack capability of the Barbarian. More of a defensive focus, or rather, they have to survive for a longer period of time. Ranger, good. From what I see, good against individuals. Not really good at handling groups. Not sure if that makes a bad choice. It has the animal companion always that allows you to do a lot of different things. Rogue, I tried, and it got horribly slaughtered pretty much immediately. Because a low deflection, another low one. Very good at hitting stuff though. The problem with the rogue, I don't think the rogue is bad. What I think the rogue is you can't jump to an level 11 rogue without already knowing what you do. You have to know how to use a rogue. You know how to equip one. What combination of abilities to use to get something out of it. And I didn't have that. So I more or less, I guess, tried to use it like I would have a straightforward warrior. And it was an absolute catastrophe. So yeah, it might be an interesting class to play in that sense, because I don't know how to play it, so it would be a learning experience while I do it. At the same time, I actually think I want to play with a priest. I think I said the priest is a very strong support caster, and probably the worst option to play as solo. I'm not sure if that's true. The more I thought about it, the less I think that's true. The reason I think it's initially thought it's true is very low accuracy, very low endurance, low deflection, basically bottom of the barrel on every front, even hill. So then the support focus. So maybe you can sort of, you're gonna have trouble surviving, and most of your abilities cannot really disable or harm enemies. So how the fuck are you gonna make it work? Buffy. Priest is one of the few characters that can very easily buff almost all attributes later on by a massive degree, by some of them. Accuracy plus 20, so it'll definitely overcome this. The difference between very low accuracy and very high is 10 points at the start of the game. And that's it. So yeah, you have probably a terrible initial experience to game, but once you get past a certain threshold, I'm not sure the priest is a bad choice. Same with the deflection. I think lowest deflection is 15 to start with. Highest might be 30. That would be the fighter. Right. But it's 15 points, and 15 points only. So yeah, I think I'll play a priest. It should have trouble surviving, and you do need to figure things out, how things work, how to buy time to get your buffs going. but I see both challenge and great potential in the priest. And it has a sort of a different mechanics with the deity system, so that could be interesting too. It has dispositions. Depending on the deity you worship, you favor certain dispositions and disfavor others. You don't have to follow them, you can play your character, but there's a sort of a negative applied to your some class abilities if you disfavor your god. We have stoic and rational. I don't think I want to do that. Benevolent and honest. I won't do this because I was sort of this character in the normal playthrough. Aggressive and clever. I don't think so. So whale or skein, really. Deceptive and clever. Disfavored, rational and honest. I think I like the skein the most. Skein, known also as the Quiet Slave, is the god of secret hatred, resentment and violent rebellion. He is usually depicted as a small, bold man covered in lash scars, whose ears and nose have been cut off. He appears outwardly submissive with downcast eyes. However, his eyes glitter black with quiet hatred, and his fist is clenched. He is known for manifest in a horrific incarnation known as the Effigy, to followers desperate enough to perform certain unspeakable rites. In Durwood, Skein's faithful often double as torturers and executioners, delighting in the fall of high-status prisoners. So, deceptive and cruel. Cannot really be benevolent or aggressive. It's an interesting combination. Benevolent would be going out of your way to help people, be friendly to them. Aggressive would be showing obvious outward aggressiveness. So you're supposed to hide your aggression, hatred, so deceptive. But still be cruel, still be very unforgiving in your administrations of punishment. So, it's an interesting combination. I'm not sure if it's a good choice, that's sort of irrelevant. I'm sure everyone can do this. Some might be better at this than others, but I don't think that's the main concern. Attributes. Yeah, this is the... actually, I'm not sure I want to play Savannah Folk. Resolve and Might. And here comes the attribute section. Intelligence is probably the most important attribute for a cleric, or a priest in this case, because it extends the duration of your spells. And with because most of your spells are buffs, you might have some damage over time spells too. So having time extended there will help both. Because usually if you have plus, let's say a buff spell, plus 10 to accuracy, it's not gonna get plus 12, 13 or 14 even if you increase might, but the duration will increase, so you don't have to probably recast the buff, or at least don't have to recast it quite so often, things like that. And if it's a debuff, it'll last longer. So I think with a priest, intelligence is more important than anything else. We have the ability to respect the character, so it doesn't matter if we make bad choices. Might does have consequence though, because we do have to rely on attack spells too. They might not work on everyone, but when they work, they should work just fine. So might is another important one. I'm not sure if we should take accuracy or dexterity after that. Or maybe deflection. Might depend on the stage of the game we're on. Dexterity and perception. Actually, the race, secondary race abilities might be more important. Once per encounter, 5 seconds after being reduced below 50. I'm not interested. Bonuses to defend against prone and stun effect. Well, that's nice, but Additional weapon set, again nice, but nothing special. Boreal dwarves gain 15 accuracy against any creature of the wilder or primordial types. That's nice, but no major opponent is of these types, so they're beasts or kith or vessel. Those are the three toughest types of the enemy bosses. Mountain dwarves have bonus defend against poison and disease. Rubbish. Against any enemy that is more than 4 meters away, that's not too far away. Wood elves gain bonuses to accuracy, deflection, and reflex. No mention of the bonus strength though, but yeah, we'd probably want to keep our distance to a target and a cast, so this could be very useful. Increased burn and freeze damage reductions. Sort of okay. Dexterity and perception. Neither of those would be our primary attributes though, but the elf bones is very nice. Orlan, again, not really our thing. When attacking any target that is also being targeted by a teammate, well, we forget about that. We do have a summoned creatures. Convert some hits to crits. So if something is attacked by a summoned creature and we attack it, we could do more bad stuff. After being subject to a will attack, Wild Orlans temporarily gain bonus to all defenses. Okay, that seems a oddly specific thing to happen. This would have godlike would have intellect. Dexterity isn't a bad thing either. When Death Godlike attacks their enemy at 25% or less endurance, an enemy with less endurance, their damage is increased, so they're good at finishing off opponents. Although damage increase is not mentioned in invite number. When reduced below 50% endurance, fire godlike glow like metal in a forge, gaining damage reduction and doing a small amount of fire damage to any creature who hits them in melee. Sucks. Every encounter when reduced below 75%, 50%, and 25% endurance, moon godlike generate waves of healing moonlight that restore endurance to them and their allies. This would be incredibly useful. So automatic sort of heal thresholds, and it's every encounter. Grants a bonus to might, constitution, and dexterity when endurance below 50%. Okay, moon godlike is different than strong choice. Not sure if I want to play a godlike. It might be interesting, but at the same time, it's either an elf or a godlike. Unusual nature, inability to reproduce. Godlike are often viewed with fear and wonder. I'd rather prefer the elf. Bonuses against distant targets. Accuracy, deflection, and reflex. So, protection against ranged attacks and accuracy when we do the same thing. Right. I definitely want intellect to be 18. Damage and healing. I don't care too much about the healing, but damage. We do have damage spells. It's a mixture between perception and might, though. If we do it to 18, that's guaranteed 24% extra damage through our couple spells. That's about it. But it's pretty much guaranteed. Perception, we can increase our chance. to cause critical hits and reduce misses and graces. So a miss is naturally 0% damage, grace is minus 50% damage, critical is plus 50% damage at the minimum. So, and the thresholds are every 25 accuracy. Yeah, accuracy is very important if we want to pretty much do anything, but is it worth ignoring might entirely? No, because you could, I can put the plus 20 accuracy right on top of this, so that's pretty much guaranteed to have no misses, and upgrades your hit by one stage. So, a guaranteed 50% increase in damage compared to a might increase. I know there's plus 20 gain, but a lower amount of perception might do. And the might would still increase that damage, so if it's more damage, it'll just, the multiplier will apply to that too. So it's not so simple. I don't know if we can increase might too much. We can, or damage too much. Accuracy we can, directly. So maybe it's better to raise might, because it's harder to raise through spells. Not sure, but we would lose out on interruption too, and reflex. Here we would just lose fortitude. Yeah, I don't know. This is something that you should put in some kind of a spreadsheet and basically see at what threshold it's better to have perception at, and at what it's better to just have might. I don't know. I mean, critical hits also increase their duration by 50%, so it's not just damage. I think I'll go with perception. I'm not sure necessarily that it's the smarter choice. Not at all. I don't want to lower endurance and, constitution. We might be able to get away with it, but it's low to begin with, and if we have to fight everything on our own, it's I don't think we can afford to weaken it. And we do have respect option, so we can change things. Right, but we were also, the perception could be viewed higher priority for another reason. The intercept is nice, reflex is nice, that's a lot of damage spells. But also because I had a high might character, so it might be nice to see what the perception offers in your gameplay, plus options. Resolve plus 1, dexterity plus 1, resolve, intellect, constitution, might, perception. Intellect might be the more important one. Old Valia. Lore. Skills. Stealth is probably worthless for us. Athletics has some value. Mechanics is important, otherwise we can't spot traps or secrets at all. Lore is very important because, yeah, while we have only fire spells, through spell scrolls we could sort of circumvent that. That other damage times and abilities in there. So lore is very important. Mechanics is very important. Athletics is slightly important. Survival again slightly, because a few points will get us those important boosts, maybe against creature types or potion use or heals or whatever. The question is, what ability has to be the highest? I think it's lore, but high mechanic is also important, so. Well, there's athletics and lore with mercenary. No. Mechanics and lore. Merchant. Right. You traded goods from all over the world, pairing items with buyers of all kinds. Good enough. That's fine. A little bit paler skin would be better suited for her. Don't think the colors matter too much. My green. I'm super green. It's not like I'm gonna even look the character after I've created it. Not sure why I'm bothering. At the same time, it's not gonna take long. Yeah. Sinister.
Well. Now, I am leader of the group. No prisoners! Keeping an eye out. Yes. Now, I am leader of the group.
Good enough. Oh, for fuck's sake. Alyssa! Right, I'll try to play through the tutorial section fairly quickly. I'm not going to try to not use the two additional Kais in this section. I just want to get through it quickly. It's not challenging either way, but it'll just take a longer time if I try to ignore the other guys.
Everybody, Polaris, tonight. I know you want to hunt before it gets much darker, but see about refilling our water first. Got a sick one here.
Okay, I need to look in through these options enough to basically try to go for the cruel and cunning options. Also, it might open other things.
They grow on a bush, nothing you won't. Of course, all the ones around here have been ran. Got different names for them. It's not if you heard. And not if the weather holds up. This time of year, they don't got. It's the sole butchers and def. Hold on.
No promise.
What kind of. Don't.
Right.
You heard the man. Let's get going before you keel over.
A pick, there's a way. It's finished.
Ooh, potion of minor endurance. Hope to. Okay, we need to find a plant and go get some water. I think that's pretty much the only things we can do at the start.
Anyone need supplies? Brought a whole wagon full of. Say, is there anything you need? I'm a trader, originally from the Adir Empire. But I've been trying to establish new business out here. Life on the road has brought some unexpected challenges, to be sure. And I'm sure you've noticed how prickly the locals can be. But we... Something else you need?
We have 110 copper. I don't even know what weapons I have. Do I even have weapons, for God's sake? Morningstar. Well, that's currently a weapon. My deflection value is 15, though. I'd like a shield. Really, really, really would like a shield.
Something else you need? It's not as big as it used to be, but it's because it's...
Well, I could take a ranged weapon too. Shields are cheap. Let's take a shield. We could probably buy some one-handed weapon too. Probably not a bad idea either. Not a lot of options. I guess it doesn't really matter what we'll take. I think I'd want to take a blunt weapon. They seem to be good against armored opponents in general. Everyone else sort of has a problem with them. Ooh, this would have a accuracy bonus though. This would have 30% graces converted to hits. I'll take a plate. +27, right. So, 12 extra points. That'll at least help. Still, I'm not exactly a frontline fighter, no matter how you look at it.
What is it?
I have 2 first level spells. I do have an attack spell here, but I have no might, so I don't do extra damage. At the same time, I have a reasonable accuracy bonus, +10 through the fortitude here. Yeah,
yes.
I think the stat screens will not favor us too much, because we don't have natural might bonuses. But in the long term, we don't get the guaranteed damage bonus, but in the long term, I think the extra quality of hits will be worth it. And as I said, we can respec the character if it turns out that I feel it's not.
Not looking forward to trying to lift that thing tomorrow.
Mm-hmm. There should be an enemy here. Wolf, I think.
I'll have your water soon enough. Stream's not going anywhere.
Let's check by those outcroppings.
Young Wolf.
Well? Hmm?
Hits. Accuracy 29, minus 14 defense. 15, roll 76. We basically should have a, thanks to our high perception, a fighter level perception accuracy levels.
As you wish. This is it.
Right. Yeah, apparently I used to be a smuggler. What happened? Double crossed while doing a deal. They made off with everything. That seems fitting for our god. Why we would be sort of very angry and bitter about it, looking for revenge. Okay. What do I look forward to? Same thing I did before. Might as well go through these options. Not like there's too many of them.
don't see me coming.
Just looking if I can spot anything special.
Keeping an eye out.
There should be a couple of items at least. Not necessarily hidden, but potions, lockpicks, that sort of thing. Recent corpse. Leather armor. Lockpick. The experience point system in this game is a bit odd. I think it's you get from quests and creatures until the point your best theory has 100% completion. After that's happened, you don't get experience from that type of opponent again. So we don't have to fight everything to get what we want. More important is just to complete missions. So how we complete them is a secondary thing.
What a surprise. Sparful went hunting. At least you left the water skin. This is recent. I see something.
Disappoint her. Terrible accuracy, minus 33% damage. Wasn't this, I think I found this. The same disappointing weapon at the end game. Plus one damage reduction for 5 minutes. Yeah, is that some kind of a joke? An inside joke I don't get. I can get it the terrible unique weapon here, but why would you get the same weapon at the end of the game? I don't get it. Maybe it's there's nothing there to get. Either way, it's not particularly amusing. Full water skin added to stash.
Sparful, are you all right?
Who knows?
Ambush! Hmm?
Ah, oh, shit. Again. A decent defense, 44. Like we're being negative 20 in our attack.
Come on, we have to get back to camp.
Don't have to do shit. Hunting bow. That'd be a better choice than a two-handed weapon. A decent amount of piercing damage, and we wouldn't have to go into the danger zone.
Yes.
Not exactly hard fights. I recall struggling with this a bit more at the start. Probably because I sucked balls, but whatever. Okay, well, yeah, you need to switch weapons to use them. Shocking. I don't want the cast unless there's some serious trouble. Yeah, the defenses are much higher than my attack values. I'm trying to flank him. Hatchet would provide extra deflection if we needed. Might be a better weapon to use in a defensive setup. I mean, if we really want survivability, we might as well go all in with the defense. 32, right. Versus 15.
What is it?
Lay down your arms. How about new? Rush the man before he can react. Go with perception. Your courage is a mask. None of you has yet slain a true warrior. Yeah, he caused an injury to him, though we could have done something a little bit better. I'm not sure I want to. Well, this type of wild fight would probably justify using spells. -5 all defenses, some piercing damage against fortitude. Or boost our own guys. +5 accuracy, 10% damage. Or damage reduction for 43 seconds. I don't think this fight is gonna last 43 seconds. Ooh, this is not good. You're gonna survive. Yeah, Yeah, rogues have fantastic damage. Crits, Clan Father, 19 damage, critical hit, sneak attack. Better fighter, better damage dealer than the fighter, definitely. Sneak attack should go in quite nicely here.
What is it?
Not too demanding of fight.
Get inside.
Probably should give him the bow. He's already damaged, so I don't want him to stand the front lines. At the same time, the critical or sneak attacks can be done through bows too. Fire at the attack.
Was that?
A Beowick. Had to be.
Then we...
Pretty sure we have extra bows. Right.
Blade in the dark.
It should be a fairly small area, but no proper enemies. We should be perfectly safe.
That should be far enough. But what now?
We look for another way out. Storm has to die sometime.
Right.
Could we maybe stay here and rest a few hours? I've lost some blood. It seems quiet off to the left. Might be a place to rest there.
I hate to say this, but we can't afford to stay put. Those Glonfathans were riled about something. Could be we got company in here. Looters will be armed and ready to kill, and there's probably a lot of them. We can't be caught sleeping in their beds.
Please, I just need to lie down for a while. Then we can move as fast as you want.
Maybe you didn't hear me. We are gonna die in here if we don't get moving and get this place figured out before the looters come back. We've either got to find the exit or a damn good place to hide.
I guess we're moving then. The injury he has is not that bad. It's a negative on the constitution. It should not reduce our combat effectiveness really. So I'll side with Kalissa. We have to press on. We don't know what we're up against.
I'll do my best.
They won't see me coming.
I want to move in sneak mode, so that's why I'm fast forwarding.
I wonder who was here. See if they left anything useful behind.
Hammer and chisel. Mace. Heavy supplies. Small shield. Torch. I think we have a couple roads here. There's direct path to the escape. It goes through traps that we have the skills to disarm. Then there's a roundabout way through some monsters. And then a bonus place here for some extra treasure. Very simple, shouldn't be too dangerous, few enemies, few in number in each individual fight. I think there's a Zorik here, that's pretty much it. Yeah, I'm just gonna kill it. raise hand, stand still. Slowly back away. Lockpicks. I didn't want to really talk to him or threaten him because we can't be overtly aggressive. At the same time, we can't be goody-two-shoes either. Ugh. Benevolent or aggressive, deceptive or cruel. I'm not sure where the rationality came from. That's not a... We can't exactly avoid all reputation. We just have to make sure we're not benevolent or aggressive, so those are the things we want to avoid. I'm not sure where the cruel and deceptiveness, what exactly is considered to feed into
horse.
Those.
Do you hear that? Well.
I might be able to break through here, if I...
Stay quiet.
Stun.
As you wish.
The entrance should be guarded by a couple of spiders. I think that's pretty much it. So there's
feels like there's a draft coming through that wall. I don't hear any sign of that storm either.
So we're not in any real threat.
So much for you.
At the moment we get a prone hit, it's sneak attacks for hidden. Exit. A hill. And a couple of gems. So, not much of a level. I'll disarm the traps and loot the specialty location. Pretty much all I can do at this point. Suppose you can solve this little puzzle too if
How
you're
can I help?
Up to it.
Worth a look.
I don't really know why you would. You don't get any experience out of this. But you do get experience from disarming traps, so seems like a better option. Twenty-five traps.
Worth a look.
15 to 45 experience per trap. It's not a huge amount of experience, but still, it's free experience, so why would you throw it away, especially at this stage where every little bit counts. We need to get past a certain threshold so we have the okay spells at our disposal.
Those tiles look suspicious.
No shit.
Let's be careful. those symbols. Just like the tiles. They won't see me coming.
I'm gonna try lighting them up. I don't think you get experience out of that. Since we've disarmed the traps, I don't see any negatives either.
What is it? So much for you. No prisoner! Yes. Kill them all!
So you need two melee guys to flank.
What is it? Where'd that slime come from?
They'll never know I'm here.
Two triplex and a wheel sim. Right. Ah, so that's the start. Our other companions should die, and we get to start our solo adventure. But we suck. We have we have almost no endurance, terrible deflection. No proper ways of killing anyone. We just need level ups. That's all it takes. But we need to do something to get those.
Oath by your brother.
And fighting is not going to be a good way to getting them. So we need to complete quests, basically. Individual opponents we can take down. Maybe two at the same time. Three is probably a stretch. Get our first level up. 1579/1000. We're on our way to level 3 already. I think there's a couple of minor tasks you can do in the first town without actually doing anything, any killing. Though something like that might be worthwhile. I need to also look at our crafting options. I need to see how far do I need to take lore. I think all around lore level 8 is probably something we want to take things. Do we want to take it higher than that? Food doesn't really require anything except the ingredients. Potions level 1. Wizards double. plus 40 deflection until hit or critically hit. Yeah, and it's fairly cheap too. Eldritch aim, extra accuracy. These don't stack though. That's one of the reasons I wanted to focus on accuracy at this point, because otherwise the future accuracy increases will basically just do little more than just get rid of fill up the hole that we started the accuracy from. But if I have an initial investment in that, it's actually going to pop it to a great level. Unique require levels. So it's every other level. Okay, at level 3 we start to have decent things. It's way above our pay grade, but still we can do interesting things. This already requires levels, so there's no real point even looking at it. We're gonna do all of it. Scrolls is a different matter. Scroll of Fan of Flames. It's this an area of effect attack spell, and some decent damage too, versus Reflex. Building Touch. 15 accuracy. Jump pose. Minor missiles. Nature's Mark. Prayer against fear. Hubble. Okay, but this requires floor 2. Or floor 4. Right, okay. What would we get from Scroll of Maelstrom? That's pretty much it. But I think it's a druid attack spell. Flame, Ice, and Lightning. And Corrosion. Not really seeing the corrosion damage though. But it is a lot of different damage types. Still, the main damage comes from Burn, which we are sort of trying to get around. So I'm not sure if this helps. Plus minus 20% attack speed, so there's at least a debuff attached to it. It's all Reflex. Here we have the Missile Barrage versus Deflection. Doesn't sound all that nice, just basically a little bit of a stab attack, but it's 9 projectiles. Okay, lower level 8 is mandatory. There's just so many good options here. Paralysis, heals, confusion, 15 accuracy bonus, walls, flame, yeah. Genuinely good things. Immunity to dazed and confused. More attack spells. This is a question mark. It does everything, but it's definitely I have doubts about do I want to go there. Piercing damage, negatives to deflection, yeah, we could use these. The duration is probably increased because of our high intelligence. So we could use a couple of these to bring their deflection and reflex down, then try to pummel with their higher damage versions. With some kind of buff and the natural accuracy bonuses these scrolls have, this could turn into a lot of damage. Right. Still, I'm certainly looking forward to raising might through other means. So, just because I chose perception here does not mean I think I don't want to get might to go up. If we can get it up, all the better. Right. I'm not sure if I'm going to do the level up here. I'll end this here. The thing is, I'm not sure where I want to go next. Lore, we don't need a high level lore at the moment. We have enough to use the initial scrolls, which is fine. Mechanics, probably we do want. level 1 is not really worthwhile. Plus 6 to trap accuracy. 9. So we can also use traps. Survival. Accuracy bonus versus creature type. You could basically prepare yourself to face certain type of bosses. I think the bonus is something like plus 6. And because it is a skill bonus, this type of a passive bonus, it stacks. There were 4 bonus groups. Things you're in your hand, so sword and shield. Items in your inventory. Your character talents and the like, then active abilities. Active abilities and normal items, with them, only the highest bonus in the group will be affected. With weapons and shields and talent type passive bonuses on the character, they stack. So we would like to get as many of these accuracy bonuses as possible. Basically force a situation where we get hits or crits constantly. Misses would be impossible. I think that might be the more important goal. So basically when we cast something, we can be guaranteed that it'll at least hit it. Stealth is nothing. I don't think I want to put anything into athletics at the moment either. So single point in survival would at least give us a single point in damage reduction. Bonus movement probably wouldn't hurt. We could at least run away from tough situation. Spread the enemies about a little bit. But at the moment, I think mechanics is a higher priority. We don't need a super high mechanics for a long time, I think. But with this, we are at least somewhat guaranteed to find what we are looking for, hidden things, and able to co-pick every lock that comes our way, at least for now. With further level ups, we need survival and lore and athletics. But yeah, the talent situation is a trickier one, especially now. Modifies Holy Radiance. Once per encounter. What does it do? Negates the reputations that negativity influence Holy Radiance. Well, I don't want this. Does a little bit of burn damage. And frightens. No, enemies take burn damage from their priest's Holy Radiance. Vessels take increased burn damage. But it's only 8 to 12 points. That's basically nothing. Interdiction. Bow area of effect days for 10 seconds. Accuracy versus will plus 15. Actually quite nice. The area of effect is huge. And days is a powerful debuff. Accuracy and dexterity. Accuracy reduced by 10. Dexterity, perception, intellect reduced by 2. Attack speed reduced by 15%. This could be, and it's once per encounter. So we could basically start the fight with a heavy disabling on the opponents, then start from there. Prey on the weak. The faithful of Skane gain an accuracy bonus with stiletto and club, gain a lesser version of rogue sneak attack ability. What is a lesser version? Plus 10 accuracy with stiletto and club, but it's a lot of accuracy, but it's only for 2 weapons. The lesser sneak attack is a passive thing though. Plus 20% melee damage and range damage. Okay, I guess that's what it means. I'm assuming it affects weapons only. So not spells. So interdiction and prey on the weak sound interesting. Radiance. Self-buff instead of healing. Well, it doesn't heal much anyway, so this could be a nice self-buff. But we're priest, we can already buff ourselves quite significantly. So I'm not sure. No, it's plus 2 to everything though. Plus 12 to your attributes. That's not a minor thing. But it's only for 14.5 seconds once per encounter. Yeah, these are the things I think we're probably going to end up switching after we learn what works and what doesn't. More allies gain accuracy bonus from Priest Holy Radiance once per encounter. Nope, nope, nope. Weapon focus, proper weapon focus. We could take a weapon focus on something that gives stiletto and club accuracy. Ruffian. So 16 accuracy bones with those two weapons. Pistol and blunderbuss and saber would also be great weapons to use, so this might be a good for us. Saber, stiletto, club, pistol, blunderbuss. Plus 5 accuracy against distant enemies with ranged weapons. I think that's I'm more interested in spells, not weapons. Could also take a weapon style, just to get deflection up. Don't have the option at the moment. Plus 6 shield deflection. Shield deflection bonus also applies to reflex. Fast runner. Plus 1 move speed, plus 5 defense when disengaging. Sign of flame would be nice. I think all the better priest attack spells are flame based. But again, we don't have any at the moment, so it would be a terrible talent to take at this point. So we basically have a couple of options. Either we try to increase our deflection values, or we basically go on the offensive. I think I'll take the interdiction now. Because a large area of effect debuff that we can use in every encounter sounds like a godsend ability at this point. Right. So, at least it's a start. The next level up we need to get as soon as possible. We cannot rely on a couple of first level spells. This will just not do. We're also major fatigue, so minus 20 accuracy, minus 25% maximum endurance. So yeah. Can we rest here? Forty-eight endurance. Accuracy is just fine, 32. Yeah, we're 1 point behind a warrior. So accuracy is very, very good. I think where it ends up being useful is against tougher opponents. It's probably better to either have a mix of perception and might, or just full might against your typical bread and butter opponents. When you have those high defense value opponents, I think you need at least something to get through the door, get your feet through the door to start bringing their defense values down. But still, I'm not saying this is the best possible choice. Interrupt could also have a unintended value. I haven't usually paid attention to that, but it might help against certain type of opponents. Bias time. Either way. This is gonna suck badly.